In 2020, a rocket will lift off to transport a new rover to Mars to investigate its subsurface for traces of bioorganisms. The Mars 2020 rover will investigate Mars with the help of a georadar for the first time. Radar waves are high-frequency electromagnetic waves that are reflected and refracted underground at layer boundaries in the same way as seismic waves are. Scientists would like to find out whether there are layers below the surface rocks on Mars that contain significant amounts of ice or water, or could contain them due to their porosity. Biological organisms may have existed or even may exist in such layers. Hello and welcome. In this video, I shall introduce you to the geophysical application of georadar, or ground penetrating radar. This is also known as GPR for short. In addition to the electrodynamic fundamentals, you shall also learn about the function of the measuring antennas and how to perform GPR measurements with them. I shall explain to you the different measuring and observation parameters, as well as the resolution and the depth at which layers of rock can be investigated. Using an example, you shall see how radar measurements on Mars and Earth are ultimately evaluated. Fundamental to the description of electromagnetic waves, including radar waves, are the Maxwell equations and the material equations resulting from them. The latter for the magnetic field reads: magnetic flux density B equals magnetic permeability mu times the magnetic field strength H. And for the electric field reads: electric flux density D equals permittivity epsilon times electric field strength E. Permittivity is also referred to as dielectric conductivity. In addition, there's also Ohm's law. Current density J equals conductivity sigma times the field strength E. The material equations show that the propagation of electromagnetic waves is determined by the material properties mu, epsilon, and sigma. The permittivity and the conductivity mainly determine the reflection properties of the subsurface and thus the contrast between subsurface layers at which the reflection takes place. A further explanation of the Maxwell equations would go too far here, but in simple terms, they express the dependencies between electric and magnetic field quantities as well as their relationship with electric current and charge carriers. They describe how changes in the electric and magnetic field mutually affect each other. They are the basis for the generation of electromagnetic waves, and from these the electromagnetic wave equations are derived. For both the electric and the magnetic field strength E and H, the wave equation applies in a charge-free space. From this, one can calculate the propagation velocity V of the electromagnetic waves. For frequencies greater than about 10 MHz, V is equal to 1 divided by the root of epsilon times mu. It can also be calculated using the travel times of waves. Together with the amplitudes of the radar waves, they represent the measurement parameters of the GPR. For most geological materials, the magnetic permeability mu is constant and equal to the magnetic field constant mu zero. Typical velocities for radar waves range from 6 cm per nanosecond in water-saturated sand and clay to 15 cm per nanosecond in dry sand or granite. In a vacuum, both the material-dependent parameters mu and epsilon are replaced by the magnetic and electric field constant mu zero and epsilon zero. Propagation then takes place at the speed of light c. The propagation path of electromagnetic waves in the subsurface have similarities to those of seismic waves. As with seismics, reflections can be used to seek out layer boundaries, and the determination of the propagation velocity allows conclusions to be drawn about other material properties. However, there are also differences in their propagation pathways that I shall illustrate to you now. Here you can see the typical propagation pathways of radar waves, where there is a layer above a half space, and next to it you can see its associated travel time diagram. The direct wave and the reflected wave you already know from the field of seismics. In addition, GPR is also associated with additional pathways that are of no significance in seismics. For example, air waves. The radar waves propagate in air at about 0.3 meters per nanosecond, making them faster than the direct wave. In seismics, it is also referred to as an air blast and only occurs where explosive sources are used. Unlike in the case of GPR, it is typically slower than the direct P wave. One characteristic that does not occur in seismics is the so-called lateral wave. This is a wave which is refracted at the Earth's surface. Similarly to the head wave in seismics, it propagates at the layer boundary with the higher wave velocity of air. Another difference to seismics is the type of wave propagation. The coupling between the electric and magnetic field vectors in GPR has no analogy in seismics. On the other hand, however, radar does not have different wave types such as P, S, and surface waves found in seismics. The active excitation of the waves is of course also a completely different scenario to that encountered in seismics. For this purpose, GPR uses an antenna. The antenna continuously emits electromagnetic pulses while at the same time being moved across the Earth's surface. For this purpose, there are different types of construction where the antenna is either more or less close to the ground. In the Mars rover, the radar antenna is only one of many measuring instruments in the lower part of the vehicle near to the ground here. The electronics are located higher up in the vehicle. Radar antennas often serve for both emitting and receiving the radar waves. For this purpose, the clock rate of the pulses must be selected so that the incoming signal does not overlap with the emitted signal. So, a special generator produces short, high-energy pulses. For each emitted pulse, one receives exactly one recorded wave train. Typical frequencies used in GPR range from 10 MHz to 2 GHz. This results in wavelengths of between 10 meters and 5 centimeters. That is approximately the spatial resolution of the radar waves. The penetration depth also depends strongly on the selected frequency and the subsurface material. It is typically within the range of 1 to 10 meters, although with very low frequencies and compact rock, this can also be deeper. Contrary to seismics, greater depth remains concealed for GPR because of the comparatively high attenuation that occurs. The radar waves are thus reflected in the subsurface at layer boundaries or heterogeneities, and the travel times are then measured at the Earth's surface. The aim of the data analysis is now to make statements on the nature, size, and location of the subsurface structures. The recorded individual tracks are first plotted side by side over time. This is what is referred to as a radargram. With radar measurements, the transmitters and receivers are usually located in one and the same antenna, so that the distance between them is constant and small. A radargram, therefore, corresponds to a seismic time section in a zero offset geometry, and many of the seismic data evaluation methods can also be applied to radar data. However, the usual seismic pre-processing steps are not necessary since the zero offset geometry is directly present with radar and does not need to be simulated by move-out correction or stacking. Unfortunately, the measurements to be made on Mars are not yet available to us, and that is why I shall instead show you an example from engineering geophysics. Initially, you can see the time section of a measurement recorded on a paved road. You can see the positive and negative amplitudes of the waveforms in red and blue. One can clearly see horizontal reflectors that sometimes appear to be stronger and sometimes appear to be weaker. In addition, so-called diffraction hyperbola form, which, as in seismics, indicate point-shaped reflectors in the subsurface. If this section is migrated, this image of the subsurface results. The hyperbola are now visible as points that are about 1 meter deep. In this urban area, point-like reflectors are usually cross-sections of cables or pipes. Such investigations are of huge importance for preparing construction projects. By using GPR, construction sites can be surveyed quickly and therefore inexpensively. Here, in addition to metallic objects, old foundations can also be located. Alongside surveys of foundation soils, GPR is increasingly being used with a similar objective in archaeological and contaminated site surveys. Here, large-scale measurements can be used to identify anthropogenic objects and structures in the subsurface. Another important field of application is the detection of water-containing layers. For example, the propagation velocity of radar waves in water-saturated rock is reduced by up to 50% compared to dry rocks. GPR, for example, is also important in flood protection for surveying of dikes and dams, as well as for the control of waste disposal sites. Or indeed on Mars, to discover whether there is water in the subsurface. In this video, I have shown you how the subsurface can be explored with the help of electromagnetic radar waves. Just as with seismic waves, radar waves penetrate into the ground and are reflected at layer boundaries. But in this case, the radar waves are emitted by antennas that also serve as receivers. The data is therefore directly available in a zero offset configuration, so that the travel times can usually be evaluated without extensive processing. Radar is sensitive to the material properties of permittivity, electric conductivity and magnetic permeability and is thus particularly suitable for locating metallic and non-metallic objects as well as for detecting layer boundaries. GPR is used for building site surveys, flood protection and archaeology and shall also be used on Mars to identify the possible presence of water-containing layers.